Okay, thank you. So the first basic question that is going to motivate the things I'll be talking about is if we consider imaginary quadratic fields. So use k to denote an imaginary quadratic field. And the question is, as k varies, how is the class group of k distributed? So how often do we get which kind of groups? I mean, you could think of this question more generally as a number field varies. How often do you get what kind of groups? But already in the case of quadratic fields, one sees, for example, that the phenomena look quite different for imaginary quadratic and real quadratic fields, as you know. And then it makes sense to sort of filter this question by the type of field. And the first case somehow is that of imaginary quadratic fields. And at least for the first part of the talk, I'm actually going to focus not on the class group, but its Celo-P subgroup. So for simplicity, I'll ask not about the class group, the whole class group, but just the P torsion for some odd P. The reason that I'm restricting to odd P is that for even P, we expect for even P, for P equals 2, we know something about this, right? We know by genus theory that two-part is controlled by the number of prime divisors of the discriminant. And for odd primes, we don't know anything at all. So the odd primes are separate from the case P equals 2, just for the fact that in this case, we really know nothing. So let me tell you what we would guess in this situation. And this comes from the Cohen-Lister heuristics. So let me define a measure. I'm going to call it mu CL for Cohen-Lister on finite abelian P groups. And I'm just going to tell you what the measure of every group is. The measure of a group G, it's essentially 1 over the number of automorphisms of the group G, except if you add those up, they don't add up to 1, of course, because already you get 1 for the a trivial group. But the sum does converge, and I'm just going to multiply by the constant that will actually make this a probability measure. So this doesn't depend on the group. It's just the constant so that these sum to 1. So maybe I should have been more clear. This is a probability measure on finite abelian P groups. And the Cohen-Lister heuristics, maybe I can just use this board first. The Cohen-Lister heuristics are the following, which is due to Cohen and Lindstra in 84, that's for reasonable functions. And they really do use the word reasonable. If you want to average those functions over class groups, so I'm going to average over fields of discriminant and most x and absolute value. So k here is always going to be an imaginary quadratic field. So I'm going to I'm going to average over the imaginary quadratic fields with discriminant most x. And over those fields, I'm going to evaluate f on their Celo-P subgroup of their class group. This should be x. So then to really get average over all fields, I'm going to take the limit at x goes to infinity, and Cohen and Lindstra conjecture that this should be the average of f with respect to this measure here. Okay, so that's that is their conjecture. And you might ask, why this measure? Why would they make that conjecture as opposed to some other distribution? So I should say one reason to believe this is that there is a good amount of empirical evidence. I mean, class groups of quadratic fields being something that we can actually compute reasonably well. Even in 1984, there was a lot of empirical evidence. And in fact, this conjecture at the time explained things that people had seen in the data that they didn't have any other explanation for. This one over odd factor explains, for example, why you see cyclic groups so often. You know, why were they seen Z mod 9 so much more as a class group than Z mod 3 cross Z mod 3? Well, that's because Z mod 9 only has 8 automorphisms, and Z mod 3 cross Z mod 3 has 48 automorphisms. Not only does the empirical evidence support this, but it was originally developed essentially to explain the data. I mean, there's also just the general philosophy that objects appear in nature inversely proportional to their number of automorphisms. Perhaps another reason is that one way to think about the class group is if we take S to be a large set of primes, in particular, enough to generate the class group, so sufficient to generate the class group, then if we look at, maybe we should have put the S on top, I guess, the ideals in K supported on S, so the ideals that are products of these primes, and we look at the map from the units, let's say the units mod the S units mod torsion, the class group, right, it's exactly the S ideals modulo the S units. So the class group is the co-kernel of this map that sends the S units into the S ideals. Okay, so all right, so far that doesn't say much. And let's say if I wanted to take the P to the infinity torsion, I could consider this as a map of ZP modules, tensor everything with ZP, and I can get the P to the infinity torsion. But the point is that, so what is this map? Okay, this is a free ZP module of rank whatever the size of S is, and this is the S units in an imaginary quadratic field. So modulo the torsion, this is a free rank S module, and so what we can do is put this together with the following theorem of Friedman and Washington from 89 that says if you take a n by n matrix, say with Haar measure from the n by n matrices over ZP, and that's just what this map is, right? It's a transformation from a free ZP module of some rank to a free ZP module of the same rank. And they say if you take a random one of those with Haar measure, then the co-kernels of those matrices as n goes to infinity go to the Cohen-Lenstra measure. Okay, so if we think, and of course, n going to infinity, we can also take the size of the set of primes here going to infinity, if you'd like. And so if we think of the class group as being built up in this way, where you take the free abelian group of ideals on some set of primes, and then a quotient out by the images of this group of units, which is the same rank, and you imagine that those matrices kind of look random, then this is another reason, maybe I should say, after the first two, that you might believe that this is the right measure, that this is how class groups are actually distributed. So I think that that is a nice, I think that that's a nice story, but I was interested if you write down these matrices, what they actually look like. So I had a graduate student, Zach Charles, compute a lot of these matrices in various ways of making sense of them, and they really don't look like our random matrices, it turns out. However, and so, so somehow this is maybe not enough motivation-wise. However, the Cohen-Lenstra measure is much more than just the measure you get from Haar random matrices. So let me tell you about another fact, which is that the Cohen-Lenstra measure is universal in a certain sense. So I'm gonna write down one example of that universality. This says that if we take a random matrix, M sub n, or random matrices here from n by n matrices over ZP, so just like from Haar measure, with independent entries, so that's like, so they're not going to be Haar random matrices anymore. We are going to require them to have independent entries, and that the entries aren't too concentrated. So, and the entries are congruent to A mod P with probability at most 1 minus epsilon, so bounded away from epsilon. So really, in terms of quantifiers, we needed to have some epsilon at the beginning of the day. Some absolute epsilon that's bounding, because, you know, of course, if you take random matrices, like the all zeros matrix is a random matrix, so you certainly don't want to do that. Or if you take matrices all of whose entries, you know, are 3 mod p, their co-kernels are not gonna look very random. But under just these hypotheses, so very general random matrices, the co-kernels converge to the Cohen-Lenstra distribution.
By the way, you said you had somebody do the experiment. What distribution did he?
That's a good question. I'll just say that the first issue, if you want to write down matrices, is you have to decide how are you going to choose the basis for your units. If you want to actually get a matrix and look at it, you have to choose a basis. So we try some different things. And then anything you try, you get distributions that are sort of artifacts of that choice. You'll get blocks of zeros, you'll get ones, you'll get numbers that are a lot, you know, bigger here. But even mod 3, they're not Haar random in any kind of choice that we can find. And so it's not in any particularly sort of beautiful distribution, because it's sort of an artifact of how you choose your basis. Okay, so yeah, that's a very good question. So I was saying that this theorem is saying that these distributions are universal in the sense of like the central limit theorem, right? The central limit theorem tells us of course it's true that if you take a Gaussian random variable and you take ID copies of it and you average them in the limit, that's a Gaussian. That's a little bit kind of like this statement. But the central limit theorem tells us you can take basically anything and IID copies of it. Those averages go to a normal distribution. And this is saying that, in fact, these don't even have to be IID. The entries, they're independent, but they can be every single entry in every one of your matrices can come from totally different distributions. So this says that it's hard, if you're picking some random matrices, it's hard to keep the coal kernels from being Cohen-Lenstra. They're Cohen-Lenstra with very strong universality. And one can prove stronger versions of this, versions, for example, that cover the kind of empirical matrices that we see. Okay, so those are some reasons why you might think that this is the right F, or this is the right measure here. Okay, so next I want to talk about, okay, so which F, I'm not going to actually try to answer this question of what exactly reasonable should mean. I just mean, which F do we like to think about? Okay, the first obvious bunches of F are the characteristic functions of various groups. Like, you want to ask the question, how often is the three part of the class group trivial? How often is the three rank two? Well, that's not a characteristic function of a group, but how often is the three CLO subgroup actually Z mod 3 cross Z mod 3? Okay, so that's the sort of maybe first kind of F that you would think to average with this conjecture. But there's another really important class of F, and those are called the moments. All right, so the moments are indexed by groups. So if A is a finite abelian P group, the A-th moment of a random group X is the expected number of surjections from X onto A. Okay? So that's just a function, right? That's a function F, the number of surjections from your group onto A. That is a function that you could average here. So we call them moments. You can actually translate them literally into mixed moments in the probabilistic sense. I'll call them actual mixed moments of the group invariance, right? You can think, well, a finite abelian group, you can just think of it as sort of a list of integers. And you can translate these into actual mixed moments of those integers. But these are, though these are, they are much more meaningful than just some numerical functions of the group invariance, as you'll see in a minute. I should say that these moments, the set of all the moments, okay, so maybe I should first say that for X, a group from this Cohen-Lenstra measure, so Cohen-Lenstra predicts that the averages of these functions here, these moments on class groups, are whatever they are for this Cohen-Lenstra measure. So that's just some sort of group theory thing that you could compute. And I'll tell you that for X from this measure, all of these moments are one. So that's, they're all one. You'd think it should depend on A, right? Because there's one for each A, but they're all one. And in fact, these moments determine the Cohen-Lenstra measure, mu CL, that it's the only measure on finite abelian P groups that has these moments. So it's a general kind of fact in probability theory that when you have actual probabilistic moments and they don't grow too fast, that they determine a unique distribution. When you translate these moments, they look like they don't grow very fast because they're just one. But in the translation to actual probabilistic moments, they become too large. They become exactly large enough that there are counterexamples. If you allowed the group invariance to be real numbers instead of integers, you would have other measures that have these same moments. However, we don't allow our group invariance to be real numbers. We want actual groups, and so it's this is a fact that goes back. It starts with work of Heath Brown and Fuvian Clooners and Ellenberg, Venkatesh, and Westerlund, and myself. In this case, there is only one. You know, despite the fact that the moments in the traditional probability sense are too large to use this sort of classical tools. In this case, one can still see that these moments determine the distribution. So then somehow morally, you could switch from thinking about these as the basic questions to thinking about the moments as the basic questions. And one great thing about these moments, okay, now here's the final point, is that they have real meaning. What's the meaning? Well, of course, since the class group of K is the Galois group of the maximal unramified abelian extension of K, if I have a surjection from the class group to some group A, some abelian group A, that's exactly a field inside of this maximal unramified abelian extension. So a surjection from the class group to A is exactly an unramified A extension of K. If by an unramified A extension you want to fix the isomorphism of the Galois group, or if not, it's up to number of automorphisms of A. Okay? So these moments, they count a meaningful thing in terms of number fields. They ask, on average, how many unramified A extensions are there of imaginary quadratic fields? Okay. And I should say, this point of view, this is also one of the main ways that this is one of the main ways which these averages over the class group have been accessed, or really anything about Cohen-Lenstra have been accessed, is not in terms of classes, but in terms of unramified extensions, which brings me to the one thing we know, the single non-trivial F for which this conjecture is known, which actually predates the Cohen-Lenstra heuristics, is the theorem of Davenport and Heilbronn from 71, which says that the Z mod 3Z moment, the expected number of surjections from the class group to Z mod 3Z, is actually 1. Okay? And they did this by counting not really anything to do, not class groups directly, but by counting unramified Z mod 3 extensions of quadratic fields. Okay. So once we're thinking about class groups with this meaning as this Galois group, then just as natural to ask about the non-abelian analog, the non-abelian class group, or otherwise this Galois group of the maximal unramified extension of K. And so you can, the question here is, this is the same question, how is this distributed? Now, in some ways, it gets a little scarier. It's often going to be infinite, unlike those that were finite. These are often infinite, and they're profinite groups. So they're these big profinite groups. Still, you can ask the question, and once you've transitioned to this question of moments, actually, their big infinite profiniteness is a little less scary because, in particular, you can just ask for these moments for any group. So for any G, what is the expected number of surjections from this? Yeah. Oh, there are a lot of stories. So let's see. So he now believes everything.
I don't know what he was talking about.
Yeah, So I'm going to mostly avoid these issues, but there's a lot of different, there are a lot of, this Cohen-Lenstra conjecture here, I think everybody expects to be true, but there are a lot of different issues if you try to generalize this conjecture. For example, if you replace Q with other fields, then roots of unity in those fields play a role that is somewhat mysterious. Luckily here, we already eliminated two, and so the only roots of unity in Q we don't see. And there are, you know, there are other issues about whether which primes should be thrown out. Like here, we threw out two. If you have non-Galois cubic fields, there's a question of, you know, first they thought you can leave two in, and then they thought you should throw it out, and now they think you can leave it in again. So there's there are a lot of questions really on how this conjecture should be formulated in generality. And so I picked this case partially to to get to ignore some of those. So I mean, I think that's very interesting. And I'll maybe say a little something at the end. Okay, so this question here, though, now, just a pretty concrete question in terms of these extensions, it's asking, as k varies, say, over imaginary quadratic fields, on average, how many unramified G extensions are there of k? Now, we're just asking that for every group, not just abelian groups. So in this not abelian setting, there are heuristics of Boston, Bush, and Hajir that address not this entire kind of scary non abelian group, but at least the P class tower group. So it's maximal pro-P quotient, the Galois group of the maximal unramified pro-P extension of K over K. So this, to think about this, we know a lot more about pro-P groups than we do general profinite groups. So you can get your head around this, I think, a little more easily than the big thing. And so already here, there's one point that we have to make that we didn't have to make in the abelian case, which is note that the Galois group of our quadratic field, right, that Z mod 2Z, say, generated by complex conjugation, it acts on this big group and, say, of course, the pro-P B quotient, say, by complex conjugation. So you have to choose a lift. I'll choose complex conjugation. And then we get an action. So we have not just a group, but a group with an action of Z mod 2Z. Now, the reason that we completely ignored this in the abelian case is because this action on the abelianization the action is by minus 1. Okay, so on the odd part in the abelianization, you can basically act by minus 1 or plus 1. If you acted by plus 1, you'd be fixed by Galois, and that would come down to give you an unramified extension of Q. So that can happen. So essentially, because Q has no unramified extensions, this action on the abelianization, so saying, okay, I have an abelian group with an action of Z mod 2Z, which is by minus 1, that's not actually any extra data. But on the non-abelian group, this is actually extra data. And so one needs to bring that into the model. Okay, so I'm going to describe the model. So Boston, Bush, Hajir developed some heuristics, and then Nigel Boston and I proved that it's the same as the following model. So before, a kind of way to think about how you get this Cohen-Lindstrom measure is you take the co-kernels of random matrices, i.e., that's like taking the free abelian group on n generators and taking the quotient by n relations by each of the columns of the matrix. Okay, and so a similar thing gives heuristics for the non-abelian case. So I'm going to let Fg be the free pro P group. On G generators, call them Xi, and then I'm going to give an action of Z mod 2Z. I'm going to let sigma generate my Z mod 2Z, and I'm going to let sigma act on these generators by inverting them.
That's good because it means it's going to act on the abelianization by minus one.
But I should say that it's by essentially the same argument, just in the non-abelian setting, this action inverts a set of generators upstairs in the non-abelian group. Okay, so that's stronger. Actually, I think actually by a theorem of Nigel's, it's not actually stronger. But Nigel Boston. But at least a priori, this is a stronger condition to say that it inverts a set of generators in the non-abelian group than to say it acts on the abelianization by minus one. But both of these are true, again, because Q has no unramified extensions. Okay, so I'm going to build a group by taking the free pro-pre group on generators. And it's going to have an action of Z mod 2Z here by taking these generators to their inverses. And then I'm going to make a random group by taking a random quotient of this group. So I'm going to take the quotient by G random relations where the Ri are independent. And they're going to be in not the whole group, because I need the quotient to still have the action of the Z mod 2 to have the action of complex conjugation on it. So they're going to be in the set of elements that are inverted by sigma. And this, so then this here is a random pro-P group, and then as G goes to infinity, this gives some distribution, just like when we took the free abelian group on n generators mod n relations, i.e. the co-kernel of a random matrix. As n went to infinity, the number of generators went to infinity, we got the Cohen-Lindstrom measure. This gives some measure, mu BBH, I'll call it, on pro-P groups with an action of Z mod 2Z. So they're chosen according, it's not exactly Haar measure, but there's a profinite measure on this set. Yeah, so it's not a group, but it has the natural profinite measure, the limit of the finite measures and all the finite quotients. Yep, and so, So essentially what the Boston Bush's heuristics can be shown to be saying is that they expect that as k varies, this model then as g goes infinity gives the distribution of what we're going to see for these p-class tower groups. Yes. So in the Boston Bush Hajir original paper, that's one of the big things in the paper is their computations. I mean, it's really actually that's a whole different story that's quite incredible, because it's very hard to compute something and then really for it to be a good evidence for this, but they have done it quite expertly. So there are lots of numerics that support this, and then I will, before this talk is over, give you another reason why you might believe it as well. So I told you, okay, everything is all about the moments. So let's talk about moments here, because there's this action, I'm calling it by sigma, of this z mod 2z here. It turns out that everything you can reduce to looking at the sigma equivariant moments. Okay, so that there's just some basic group theory that reduces non-sigma equivariant moments to moments, i.e. surjections that are actually equivariant for a z mod 2z action on the two groups. And so these are really the relevant moments here. And so Nigel Boston and I show that if X is a mu BBH group, so taken with respect to this measure here, where you take the free group on G generators modded out by these G relations that sit inside here, so that there will actually be a sigma action descending to the quotient, then these moments are one. So that's kind of, that's another piece of evidence. You know you got the right thing when all the moments are one in this group. For all G with a generator inverting sigma. Of course, if there's not an involution that inverts generators on the group, then it's never going to be a quotient of this thing that has this involution on its generators. And I should say that it's known. You might wonder, okay, we did all these crazy things. It is these things are known about this group in this sense, which it is known by Koch and Venkoff that for an imaginary quadratic field, this P-class tower group actually has a presentation of this form with G generators and G relations, where the relations can be chosen in this set. Okay, so we show that these moments are one, and that these moments determine mu BBH. Yeah, no. So I mean, we know that the pro P part is this is known. The pro P part is always finitely generated. Yes. Yeah. So yes, we know that about the pro P part. Yes. So it always has some finite number of generators and can be presented with the same number of relations and the relations in that form. Okay. Okay. So if we focus on the moments or the average number of, say, for your favorite finite P group, the average number of unramified extensions with that Galois group, the Boston-Bush-Hajir heuristics would predict that those are one. And then let me just say, a reason to really believe this is that we then prove a theorem about class groups in the function field analog. All right, we're still very far off from knowing anything like any of this in any kind of generality for number fields, but with serious work, the modern tools are beginning to make some progress on the function field side. Yes?
So quadratic imaginary.
Yes, so I, for the purposes of this talk, I am restricting to that, but I can say more about other cases. Yes.
So for number fields, yeah.
Yes, yeah, no, so this is a great question. Okay, so this then gives, this is a distribution on pro P groups, and what you might want to know is what is the measure of p-adic analytic groups, but we don't know. So obviously Nigel Boston, you know, is knows as much about this kind of question on pro P groups as anybody. And we've thought about this. but of course, you know, you would like to say that this predicts unramified front-end measure, but that's just a question about pro-P groups and this measure on pro-P groups that we don't know the answer to. So, that's a lovely question. Now, just on the group theory side, then to know, you know, because somehow this, it makes a conjecture about that. You just don't know which one, which way the conjecture goes until you know the fact about the measure of analytic groups in this, from this construction. Nigel Boston has lots of conditions on the groups that, but it still seems hard. Even P groups are not. They're not quite as nice as abelian groups. So, yeah, great question. I love that question, but don't have a good answer. All right, so the so let me try to state a function field theorem. Okay. So maybe I have to first, maybe before I even said theorem, I should have done this. I have to first now translate us. K is your imaginary quadratic field. I got to translate us into the function field side. So you just go back to the beginning, and you replace Q with FQT for some function field, and now. What an imaginary quadratic field is. It's a quadratic extension ramified at infinity, or you can think of it as a hyperelliptic curve ramified at infinity, right? It's the function field of that. And we have to actually be a little, there's a small thing that you need to do with this Galois group, which is, you need to replace just asking for unramified extensions with the following. I'm going to write an infinity up here. We're going to ask for the maximal extension that's unramified everywhere and split completely at infinity. Now, of course, this didn't change anything over Q. In the number field case over Q, if I say, okay, I want to look for extensions that are unramified everywhere and split completely at infinity, unramified and split completely are the same at infinity. But in the function field case, they're not the same. And this is the thing you want. It just turns out. If you think about the number field function field analogy, it can give you a dozen reasons this is the right thing. For example, this is the thing whose an abelianization is the affine class group. The abelianization of this thing is the Picard group, which has this, you know, quotient to Z. It's not a finite abelian group. It's not the affine class group. This is the thing whose abelianization is the affine class group. So this is the thing. Okay, this theorem is going to need lots of boards. Okay, so this is all just the preamble. The preamble of how you make the function field analog. Okay. So now, okay. Maybe I'll sort of, I'll write various hypotheses. Let's see, so for H finite odd group, okay, what we would like to prove was the function field analog of the Cohen, of the Boston-Bush-Hajir heuristics would predict is that the expected value of the number of surjections from this unramified split completely at infinity Galois group to H is always 1. Okay, I left a little space because that is not quite what we prove. So when I write this expected value for the class groups, remember actually it's implicitly a limit as x goes to infinity of the expected value where you take the ones up to discriminant x. Okay, so it's really a limit. All right, so we actually don't know that that limit exists. Not at all an obvious kind of thing, but there's certainly a lim sup and a lim inf. So I'm going to write e sup and inf here to talk about the two possibilities. There's a lim sup and a lim inf. That really is a thing. There's a lim sup and a lim inf. Obviously, if we prove those were both one, then I wouldn't be talking about that. But what we prove, and there's going to be I'm about to write it. Okay, so what we prove here, there's going to be some more hypotheses. Okay, some more things is a statement about the limit as q goes to infinity of both the sup and the inf, and they're one. Okay, all right. So there's a few things to say. Okay, so first of all, H, right, and has to have a sigma that's acting on it by generating and sigma, a generator inverting involution on H. And then there are some conditions on Q. So Q should stay relatively prime to 2 in the size of H, because otherwise you just get into wild nonsense that really is not the analogy of the number field side. And then Q minus 1 also needs to stay relatively prime to H. And that is, I mentioned earlier that there's some issue with roots of unity in the base field. And so when Q minus 1 is not relatively prime to H, they're roots of unity. So we still prove a theorem. It's just not 1. It's a different distribution because they're roots of unity in the base field. You still get an answer without this condition, but you just get a different answer. You get 1. Okay, so I think I've got enough decorations there. So a couple of things. So first of all, if you're just thinking about FQT because it's the rational function field and it's like the analog of Q, you didn't care what little q was. All little q's are all FQTs are supposed to be like Q. So letting this Q go to infinity shouldn't really affect whether you believe that these averages are 1 over Q, which I think you should, even though we're very far from being able to prove something like this. And I also want to say a little bit, this is a kind of technical issue. Of course, letting Q go to infinity is one of the big things you can do in the function field case that you can't do in the number field case. And yeah, exactly. So I'm exactly going to say, so in the whole business, there's a sort of hierarchy of when you cheat. Okay? And so this here, when I write this sup inf, the x went to infinity. And that happened before the q goes to infinity. And that doesn't sound like anything, but when you actually try to prove the theorems, that's a big deal. So it's much easier and much softer to prove a theorem where the q goes to infinity before the x goes to infinity. Then it's just about, well, I'll talk about the proof. But anyway, so I do want to emphasize that here, q is fixed. There's a lim sup and a lim inf that we prove exist that are actually finite, so that for a fixed Q is completely a new kind of thing. And then to get the actual values to go to 1, we then later take Q go to infinity. And that's just it's a much harder thing to do than letting Q go to infinity first, which sometimes is all you can do. But in this case, in this case we get this strong.
Also no such thing as like for Q large enough, this is true. It actually has to take a limit.
Yeah.
So it's not really known for any given.
It's not nothing. It is not. There's not a moment that is known for any Q. Though I should say that, unlike the number field case, where we basically do not have any idea where to even start and pick up something, this theorem is just kind of where things are with our knowledge now. It's not the limit of some approach. I'm going to talk now about the approach to this proof, and there's no obvious wall in the approach to proving the entirety of the theorems for a fixed Q. It's just, you know, it takes work and it takes new theorems and understanding. Yeah. So I'm going to talk about there. Oh yes. Okay. So Ellenberg, Venkatesh, Switzerland for the abelian moments had thought they had had a stronger statement, but they don't. But they're big players in the development of this whole theory and machine. So let me talk about the approach. I mean, it's part of a bigger program that goes back. The program started with work of JKU, and then he had this unpublished preprint that kind of sketched out the ideas, and then Jeff Ochter proved some of the first theorems on this, and then Ellenberg, Venkatesh, and Westerland proved really restarted this program with some real new serious topology and great ideas and great machinery for it. And in particular, in the case when H is abelian, essentially when it's abelian. This is their theorem, or close to it. And let me tell you what the idea is. So remember that these moments, they count extensions of FQT. Well, that's like counting curves with maps of some degree that you know to the line. So these extensions are parametrized by Hurwitz spaces, by moduli spaces of curves with a map to the line. So they're the FQ points or something close to that of various moduli spaces, and the overarching approach is to count the FQ points of the moduli spaces using the Groth and Dieck-Lefschetz trace formula. And then, okay, so then you have to know something about the atoll cohomology of the moduli spaces and to use some kind of comparison and use, you know, topology to prove things about the cohomology of the moduli spaces, which you then translate into things about the atoll cohomology of the moduli spaces, which lets you count to count FQ points. So that's the overarching shape of the program. And so maybe you can see what I was saying, that there's no particular wall to using this to count for a Q fix the whole thing, except that there's a lot of technical details. I mean, and a lot of work that has to be done. First of all, there's sort of major work in new work in topology that has to be done to prove these things. The moduli spaces you actually need get kind of thorny. Even the comparison theorems sometimes need new results. So in the weeds of the technical details of actually doing this, there's a lot of things to be done. Yeah.
So I was also just wondering, so in the context of abelian class groups, you can also look at, instead of class groups, look at reclass groups.
Yes.
You know the difference pretty well. In this case, mm-hmm. how strict is this unramified condition? Like in the method, is it?
So the question is whether it could get you some, you're just saying, could you get something for Ray class groups?
Yeah, suppose that you get
a... Yeah, absolutely. Now you have to start making, some specifications at other places. So now you've got some different, different topological spaces that you're talking about. But, at this level of generality, yeah, there's absolutely... nothing to stop you from trying to say something about Ray class groups, or instead of over the rational function field, over other curves. Now you just have topology. There's still moduli spaces of finite covers of curves. Those are things. But anyway, the method is only so good as you can actually you can do the parts of them. But none of them seem beyond the scope of human minds.
something you must have had to do, and that is the fact that you're fixing Q and getting the
limit, yeah,
means that you have to have a stable range, right?
So,
a long stable range of understanding
the right. So this requires bounding. Bounding the unstable, not only having a stable range, but bounding the unstable cohomology, right? Like you could try to use this same program to count the number of curves of, apply it not to the Hurd spaces, but to MG. You try to count the number of curves of genus G over FQ, one of my favorite questions, but you have no control over this unstable cohomology that's just... super large, and so you can't actually say anything with Groth and Nick-Leschetz that you can prove. So, but here these Hurwitz spaces, they seem better. You actually can prove bounds on the unstable cohomology, so you know it's not a situation like MG. You prove bounds on the unstable Betti numbers. I will just end by saying that even though I was talking about these Boston Bush Hajir heuristics for pro P groups, this theorem is actually for any odd group. Okay, so that's more than we have even conjectures for. Though I'm very actively thinking about sort of what is the right model of random groups that would give us these moments for pro odd or just general pro finite groups. All right, thank you.